The case, the informant of this case was her mother, and the history is reliable. Her mother is educated up to 10th standard, and they belong to a lower middle class of socioeconomic status according to modified Kuppuswamy scale.
1 minute before you go to the next thing. See,
Yes, ma'am.
people are using gender interchangeable. The word gender means the social responsibilities given. Okay, it should be sex. Sex,
Yes,
male or
ma'am.
female. Okay, whenever I say gender, it is what the community, like a girl means she should be wearing girls' clothes and she should be cooking like that. So don't use gender when you are doing a case presentation, it is sex. Social
Yes, ma'am.
roles in society is called gender. Sex is the anatomical external part of your sexual organs. So it is sex and not gender. Okay, informant,
Yes.
okay, please correct that. Next.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah.
She presented with the chief complaints of fever from past 4 days, cough from past 3 days, and hurried breathing since past 3 days.
Yes, next one.
History of present illness. The child was apparently normal 4 days ago when she developed fever, which was sudden in onset, high grade, intermittent in nature, present throughout the day, and it was associated with rigors. The child was not active in between afebrile episodes. The fever was partially re relieved on medications, and it was not associated with any rashes.
1 minute. You said intermittent in nature, and
Yes, ma'am.
immediately you're saying present throughout the day. It doesn't go together. What do you want to
Yes, ma'am.
say? The fever
It
is.
was the fever was intermittent because of the initially it was present throughout the day. After she was taking medication, it was partially relieved and it became intermittent in nature.
Yeah, so that is you should be very careful about the terminologies, okay? Because whatever
Yes,
we
ma'am.
say, continued fever, intermittent fever, remittent fever, I would not like to use those terminologies in history of present illness because these terminologies are based on the temperature chart which you record. So I would like to say
Yes, ma'am.
if I were you, I would like to say the fever was present throughout the day, and after medication,
Yes, ma'am.
the fever was present in between like that. Okay, words
Yes, ma'am.
intermittent are all based on recording of the temperature chart, so you still not touch the child, so we can't use the term intermittent. Okay,
Yes, ma'am.
what do you mean by rigors? This
Ma'am,
child
rigors
is
is the muscular contractions which happen in order to increase the body temperature.
okay. Do you think this child, 1.5 years old child, had rigors? Unlikely. Where did you get that
Okay.
history? What did the mother say? Okay. And one more thing is, whenever you're doing a pediatric examination, please ensure that you carry some toys. And the best way to interact with the child is having a nice keychains. You know, the child get attracted and it can be distracted from getting fear, because this child is 1.5 years. No, they'll have social insecurity and all that. The child will start crying. That's another thing which I wanted to tell in the beginning. So you can't. The child will not have rigors.
Yes,
Very difficult. It's I can tell you that I had a cold feeling. I'm feeling I have rigors like that, but not a
Yes,
child.
ma'am.
Okay.
Okay, ma'am. I'll go to the next slide, ma'am.
Yeah, your slides are excellent.
She developed cough 3 days ago, which was insidious in onset. There was no diurnal variation, there was no postural variation, and there was no episodes of vomiting after bouts of cough. She
Yeah.
also had complaints of hurried breathing since past 3 days, which was progressive in nature, and it was associated with noisy breathing.
Okay, we'll stop here. You said she had cough. First, she had fever. Then, she developed cough. Insidious is a word which we use in malignancy. The word insidious means slowly creeping. Something that
Yes.
happens as acute as this, you can't use the word insidious. Okay, she developed
Okay,
3 days
ma'am.
ago. Okay, which was sudden in onset, or it was subacute in, I mean, she developed cough 3 days ago. That's it. No insidious
Yes, ma'am.
onset. Okay. And very good
Yes, ma'am.
cough, you have diurnal variation. So, which are the coughs that have diurnal variation?
Ma'am, if it is because of some bronchial asthma or something like that, the cough bouts
Very
during
good.
both night and
Very
early
good.
morning periods.
Yes. See, one of the most important diagnostic significance is, if a child has bronchial asthma, the mother will tell us the child had nocturnal cough. Okay, if they were postgraduates, but there is something called as Pediatric Clinics of North America. It's an excellent review of nocturnal on cough only. So diurnal variation means if the child has cough more at night, it is number one, bronchial asthma. Number two, any other allergic conditions. Okay, you said no rashes there in the beginning. We'll talk about it later. Then which are the coughs that have postural variation? So it's a very nice thing that you have brought about no diurnal variation. Though 1.5 years is a little early to talk about asthma. What about no postural variation? Which are the conditions?
Postural variation is if there is any cavitation in the lung on one side and the child sleeps on the opposite side, the purulent material will get drained into the respiratory tract and cause irritation leading to cough.
Very good, Shashank. But 3 days history, no, is too short for a child to go through all this.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. And so, one more.
Yeah.
Gastroesophageal reflux can cause.
Yeah, you should have said GERD. I would have accepted that. Okay. But not cavitary lesion. And that pus pouring into the normal lung and causing a cough that will not augur well. Okay, so you should have said no diurnal variation, no postural variation. I accept it. Followed by no episodes after bouts of cough. What is the terminology we use in pediatrics? It's called
post-tussive vomiting.
Yeah, post-tussive cough or vomiting. Okay, next one. And hurried breathing since 3 days. See, this word's progressive, insidious, all that should be used for a rule of thumb. What is the rule of thumb?
No medical term.
Rule of thumb to say acute, subacute, and chronic.
Ma'am, acute is generally any condition which was 2 weeks.
Very good.
2 weeks.
Yeah.
And greater than 4 weeks or 6 weeks, depending on the condition, it is chronic. Whatever is in between these two.
Okay. So rule of thumb is less than 2 weeks is acute. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Two to six weeks is subacute.
Yes, ma'am.
6 weeks to 6 months is chronic. It's not given in any books because we've been teaching for the past 35 years. No. So this is a thing that we have accepted. This is what we'll say acute, subacute and chronic. So when you've got an acute condition, we'll not be talking about progressive in nature. What exactly do you mean by progressive in nature?
It means that the symptom is like getting worse day by day.
Okay. The cough has increased or the developed cough 3 days ago. So she says she has a continuous cough, hardly any respite between the coughing episodes, something like that. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Next one.
The child is dull and irritable. There is no history of excessive crying. No history of nasal discharge, running nose or ear discharge. No history of vomiting or diarrhea. No history of bluish discoloration of lips and extremities. No history of lethargy or episodes of unconsciousness. And no history of seizures.
So what you should write is, you told me all about the positive history. Now you are telling me this is called as pertinent negative history. Okay.
Yes,
because
ma'am.
Pertinent negative history is required to pitch in for respiratory problem or is it a non-respiratory condition. So instead of writing for every symptom, you should say no history of excessive crying / nasal discharge, running nose, ear discharge, okay, like that.
Yes, ma'am.
And bluish lips and extremities will come little up and then the other things. So here what you're trying to do is history or symptom analysis of the system. So we got cough, we got fever, cough, and we have got hurried breathing. So what system do you think it predominantly belongs to?
I think it predominantly belongs to respiratory system.
Yeah. So what are the other symptoms the child should have had to pitch in for respiratory system? You said?
Ma'am.
Nasal discharge, I agree.
Yes, ma'am. And nasal discharge or running nose.
Yes.
Then she can have a credit
okay,
sounds
according
like
to you,
granting
what is
or visa.
What is what according to you, what is upper respiratory infection?
Upper respiratory tract is any inflammation above the glottis,
epiglottis. Okay. At imaginary line drawn above the epiglottis. Which are the structures that come above the epiglottis?
Nasopharynx.
Yes.
Oropharynx, tonsils.
Oropharynx, tonsils. Very good.
Then laryngitis, epiglottitis.
That is low respiratory. Epiglottitis, yes, is that cut off.
Yes,
okay.
Yes,
so above that you have got pharyngitis. Okay. You can get rhinitis. You can get paranasal problems, but the child is 1.5 years.
Yes,
so
ma'am,
we can't have that. Rhinitis. Then you got a ear discharge. Then low respiratory tract infection, because the child has got hurried breathing. You're saying that hurried breathing is progressive. So we have to consider something of the low respiratory. So what are the components of the low respiratory tract? You just now told me epiglottitis.
Yes, ma'am. Laryngitis, then tracheobronchitis, bronchiolitis.
Yes, very nice. Because 1.5 years this child is a little older for bronchiolitis, but still you have to consider that. So what are the associated symptoms of that? Pharyngitis, how will it be? Tonsillitis.
Ma'am, tonsillitis, the child will have a reduced feeding because of pain. There will be dysphagia.
Okay.
And ma'am, on examination, we can make
only history. What will you ask the mother? What will you ask the mother?
Mm.
Again, tonsillitis too early, because tonsillar hypertrophy, tonsillar growth starts a little later. So what will you ask? Somebody has put up in the group. Sore throat or crying. Okay, whenever the child is trying to swallow something, child have this difficulty in swallowing. Okay.
Drooling of saliva.
Yeah. So what is drooling of saliva and neck swelling and some change in the voice? You should become immediately alert, because it can be as acute as this. Which condition? You just now told me.
Yes, ma'am.
What is that? Epiglottitis. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
This is a time when we don't allow of examination of the throat. But currently, we are not allowed to do throat examination. Other thing, next, what would be the symptom of the laryngitis?
Ma'am, there will be change in voice.
Very good, Shashank. Very good. Okay. So, laryngitis, the mother will say change in the voice. Okay. And what is that condition called as? I don't know. We are very fond of asking in the exams, what is crew? So
croup,
people say croup and all that. So croup is involvement of the laryngeal box, and when the larynx is involved, there is a change in the voice, etc. Okay.
Yes,
suddenly, why this is vomiting and diarrhea came here? I accept vomiting, but why diarrhea?
Ma'am, for multisystem involvement, to rule out viral etiology.
Vomiting agreed. Diarrhea.
Again, if it was a viral etiology, the child is swallowing all these secretions and it's leading to.
No. Yeah, I think we're imagining too many things. It's a respiratory case. Fever, cough, and hurried breathing. Okay. Vomiting, because GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease or disorder. Okay. So vomiting, I accept. Diarrhea, I'm not satisfied with your explanation. So we are jumping away from a respiratory system to gastrointestinal tract. It is not all right. Okay. So we said respiratory system, upper respiratory tract, complaints we took, lower respiratory tract complaints we took. What would be the associated system that can present with such an acute presentation? Because you suddenly jump to bluish discoloration of lips and extremities. Do you think they're justified in asking about that? Cyanosis is a feature of respiratory infection. All right. Are you thinking
if it
this child
severe respiratory infection, then cyanosis?
Yes. Yeah. So I will accept that discoloration of lips and extremities with a slight pinch of salt. It should still come lower down. Whereas lethargy should come below ear discharge. Okay. In one sentence, I say there is no history of excessive crying, nasal discharge, which is otherwise running nose, ear discharge, no history of bluish discoloration, lips and extremities, lethargy, or loss of consciousness. And then what do you mean by seizures, convulsions, and epilepsy? When you're talking, when you're taking the history from the mother, we should be very careful about the terminologies. Okay. What do you mean by seizures?
Seizures means CNS irritation will lead to the
seizures means
vigorous contraction of the muscles.
Seizures means electrical discharge. Okay. So the mother will not be able to make out the electrical discharge. Epilepsy means repeated things. Okay. Repeated attacks. Okay. Seizures will not be in history. You will say no history of convulsions. We talk very commonly of febrile convulsions, right? So no history of convulsions would be a better word. So be very careful about what you use. You know, if these books are available, there is Symptoms and Signs by Illingworth. Very nice. He describes each of those complaints. Just at bedtime, you can keep it next to your bed and start reading those things, because it's a golden opportunity to, for you to go through those books. So seizures, the word seizures is not used here. So why did you ask about lethargy? Why did you ask about unconsciousness and convulsions?
Lethargy is respiratory symptoms have progressed so severe that the child is becoming hypoxic, and that is leading to reduced activity and drowsiness.
Very good. What's the next one? Episodes of unconsciousness.
Unconsciousness, again, if it is so severe that the child will become hypoxic, leading to all metabolic disturbances.
No, don't use that term, metabolic disturbances at MBBS level. So IMNCI, we say, Integrated Management of Neonatal and Childhood Illness, above the age of 2 years, we say the danger signs are rhomboid. Okay. In that we say lethargy and unconscious, vomits everything, refusal of feeds. Okay. Just not recollecting the four. You can ask those four danger signs. Okay.
Yes.
Lethargy or unconsciousness, vomits everything, refusal of feeds, one more component. I'm not remembering it. I'll tell you as we progress. Okay. So that is what you're trying to tell there. You're trying to tell there that I'm trying to get the history of general danger sign. The general danger signs can be used only after the age of 2 months to 5 years. Below 2 months, we don't have the general danger signs. We have some 10 components. Okay. Okay. Next.
Next slide, ma'am. This is treatment history, ma'am. That is, she had given a paracetamol 5 ml syrup 3 times a day before she came to the hospital.
Okay. Okay. Whenever you're talking or giving any medicine to the parents, no, what are the instructions and what would you like to ask in that history?
Ma'am,
suggested
these medications.
Yes, number one.
And then
you said just paracetamol. Calpol is available as 125 milligram per. Yes, Shashank. Hello. Yeah, paracetamol, you must get the dosing there, right? We say all pack. Okay.
Yes.
Ask, listen, praise, advise, counsel. Shall I repeat it? You'll ask the mother. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
All pack. A. You will listen. You will praise her, but at the same time to get the proper history. I'll pack, practice, advice, and counsel. Yes. So what is happening, you know, especially during this COVID times, there is a lot of panic among the mothers that they should suppress the fever. So they're going on giving paracetamol syrup, right? Every 30 minutes, 45 minutes hourly. So when you are giving a paracetamol syrup, you must tell them how much to give, how frequently to give. And once the syrup is given, when will the fever come down? So now you have given the syrup. So when do you think the fever will come down? This instruction should be told to
At least it will take 1.5 to 2 hours.
2 hours. No, at least. You know, scientific knowledge is very precise. Sometime, if I have time, I would like to take a class for you guys on fever an enigma, you know, just all about fever. So when you give paracetamol, you must tell the mother it takes minimum 2 hours for the temperature to come down. So don't panic and give some more dosing of paracetamol. What is the next instruction that you will give? You're from Karnataka, right, Seshank? Hello?
Yes, ma'am, Bangalore only.
Yeah. So what is the next instruction you'll tell the mother?
I'm from Bangalore only.
Yeah. What is the next instruction you will tell the mother? So many of the times the mothers feel very anxious.
Ma'am, I'll tell about...
Along with fever.
Yes, ma'am. So I'll counsel about... I'll ask her to tell about any other symptoms she has.
No. With any, paracetamol.
Any other symptoms the child has.
No, we finished the symptoms. No.
Ma'am, so, I'll tell her not to...
I'll tell her not to
worry and start giving repeat doses.
Yes. What is the other thing that you will tell her? Whenever a child has got fever, there will be a lot of congestion in the oropharyngeal area. Okay. So the child will have, hypermetabolic state, child will have a sensation of vomiting. So when the paracetamol is given, ask the mother to wait for 2 hours and wait till the temperature comes down. Then only she can give something to eat or drink. What will happen? As it is, they are very worried about the fever. And once you try to feed the child will vomit. And the child will go through a lot of anxiety and fear, because the child will think, oh my God, that vomiting, that sensation of vomiting puts the child in a lot of distress. So all this should be told to the mother. Okay. And the other thing is, what is the other thing you'll tell the mother when the child has fever?
She can continue home remedies like sponging and all.
Not sponging, routine bath. Why sponging? When the temperature is high, it's okay.
Yes,
the child will go through a routine bath. Okay. Routine bath, routine food. Okay. And then not over cover the baby.
Yes,
normal clothes. Okay. The moment they have fever, they never allow the fever to come out only. And these are the situations where children go for febrile convulsions. We should bring down the temperature. Yes, one with paracetamol, switching on the fan, if they have a fan, routine bath, routine food, 2 hours after paracetamol. All this instruction should be given from the pediatrician. See, pediatrician, one thing is, you are a family doctor, because you are trying to take care of your child through an intermediary person, and that's the mother. Okay? Yes, Seshank, proceed. You have any doubts in this?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
From past history, the girl had visited the child clinic for routine immunization and is immunized up to date in a government hospital. Illness visit is, there was no such similar complaint in the past. So there was no OPD visits or admission to the hospital.
Okay, illness visit, last time I have told in the class that it will be OPD visits and inpatients. So OPD, no OPD visits at all.
That was only for immunization, ma'am. Other than that, there was no other.
That I know. I have noted down that point. Very good. Your people have incorporated wellness visits. Illness visits, the child never visited the OPD in the past 1.5 years. So illness
according visits, to her, she says.
Okay. Illness visits can also be OPD visits. Okay. Illness.
Yes,
you should put illness visits as OPD and inpatient. So both, there was no OPD visits, no inpatient visits. Okay, very good.
Okay.
So what is happening? What is happening now? This child seems to be born somewhere at the beginning of this pandemic, because 1.5 years old. So normally we would have had a child below the age of 5 years visit our OPD for what? Below the age of
for routine immunization.
No, wellness visits. I'm not talking about wellness visits, Shashank. Illness visit.
Yes, ma'am.
Illness visit. What is the common illness visits children were coming to the OPD before the pandemic?
One thing is not gaining enough weight.
No, viral respiratory infections. Okay,
yes,
don't
ma'am.
Get into all that. So a child below the age of 5 years will have 5 to 8 viral respiratory infections. Therefore, antibiotics are not at all advised below the age of 5 years, except in some conditions, right? So the fact that the hospital's visits have come down for the viral respiratory infection is one side very good news. The other side, I'll tell you, why do you think the viral respiratory infections have come down in children and their OPD visits have come down? Can you guess?
And one thing is parents are taking extra precautions.
Very good. Because of a respiratory hygiene, wearing of masks, hand washing has really brought down the viral respiratory infections and visit to the hospital. Because in any OPD, you know, it used to be nearly 30 to 40% of the OPD patients were for respiratory infections. So if that's the good news, what is the bad news? What is the bad news?
The thing is, even though some children have these illnesses, the parents are not coming forward.
Okay, a delay in seeking treatment. What is the other thing that is happening because the children are not having the respiratory infections?
Body immunity is not developing.
Yeah. See, my professor, Dr. Nirmala KC, used to say, children are so well protected by their creator. Below the age of 5 years, innocuous. You know, it comes and goes. Those kind of a viral respiratory infections are very common. 5 to 8 visits per year is very common because their immunological system and the innate immunity has to be trained. So the training starts with this innocuous, not so distressing viral infections. So that has caused what? That has caused the third wave, which we are going to face, which I want all of you to ensure that it doesn't happen by emphasizing on SMSVIC. Okay, you all know about it. Social distancing, mask, sanitizer, and vaccination. So these children in the future will be more prone for a severe form of disease because their immunological system is not reminded like earlier days. Am I clear, Prashant?
Yes, ma'am.
Shashank? Yeah, okay, next one.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Next one.
Antenatal history.
Mm-hmm.
First trimester, the child was the first born in the family. The case is a registered case and the pregnancy was confirmed in their home by a urine pregnancy test after 1 month of amenorrhea.
Mm-hmm.
There were no complaints in the first trimester and there was no history of drug intake or exposure to radiation.
And eruptive fevers.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. You should never say no complaints in first trimester. You can say no history of drug intake, exposure to radiation or eruptive fevers. Exposure to radiation, what exactly do you mean? One CT scan will cause how much of radiation hazard? One chest X-ray will cause how much of radiation hazard? Why are we so much bothered about the radiation? All that you must know, okay? Because in the first trimester, there will be a lot of teratogenic effects. And then you must also say what else? So drug intake, exposure to radiation and eruptive fevers. I would like to use the word eruptive fevers. Okay. Why are you so much bothered about these three things? And which are the drugs? Can you tell me one or two drugs that can cause some problem?
Chloramphenicol, vancomycin.
Okay. Thalidomide. The famous erythromycin.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you must know one or two drugs. What happens, you know, you are so used to just saying no drug intake. Suddenly the examiner will ask you, can you tell me one or two drugs which can cause teratogenic effects? Okay, so the most common teratogenic effect was thalidomide. Then any other drugs? Mother taking warfarin, what will happen? You know, mother who is on a chronic disorder. So one or two drugs you remember, okay?
Yes,
eruptive fevers were finished? Okay, then what else would you do in first trimester?
Folic acid intake.
Yeah. Next, folic acid. When should it be taken?
Ideally, it should be taken before pregnancy itself if it's a planned pregnancy.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it should be started in first trimester.
Whenever the couple are going for the honeymoon, give them a packet of folic acid. It should be preconceptional. Folic acid is supposed to prevent neural defects. Now, for an undergraduate, it is okay, but things are changing. So she's taking, will she take prophylactic iron and folic acid in the first trimester or is it in the second trimester? Folic acid is okay. Will she take iron in the first trimester? We start iron in the second trimester.
Yes, ma'am. First trimester, there will be a lot of gastric irritation and iron will predispose to.
Yeah, we are talking about 100 days. Now, according to the 1000 days, 1000 days program, which is called as empowering parents in child care, we start the iron and folic acid, unlike 100 days, now it is extended for 6 more months. 3 months would have been 100 days, now it is 6 months.
Yes.
What else would you do here? Did she take the first dose of tetanus toxin?
The
moment you say that this child, this pregnancy is registered, it automatically means she has taken tetanus toxoid, her hemoglobin would be done, HbSAg, HbSAg blood group, all that will be done in the first trimester itself. And what else? Ideal recommendation is either we do a dating scan, anomaly scan. Okay, anomaly scan comes in the second trimester, dating scan comes in the first trimester. And what else?
Yes, ma'am.
What else? Because modern, all this. A high affluent society and all that. Of course, we should be doing it for everybody. What else do they do? What is quadruple test? Quadruple test? Because sometimes parents are coming with the test report and asking you.
No. It is like having four parameters. It will have the estrogen levels. It will have
estrogen levels. Very good. Next.
Ma'am, it's basically done for screening of Down syndrome and some congenital anomalies, ma'am.
Yeah. So you must know the quadruple test. One is estrogen, human.
It will have HCG, AFP, and.
Yes. One more. Very good. Anyway, nuchal translucency. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
One important thing that you should remember is nuchal translucency for Down syndrome can be picked up only in the first trimester. If you have missed first trimester, that important nuchal translucency will be missed. You know, all this will have gained a lot of importance post-COVID pandemic, if at all we come out of this, because the enormous drugs they are giving, the enormous things that are happening in the atmosphere will have an impact on the pregnant woman. So you do a quadruple test with a rider that you should never miss a nuchal translucency, which should be done only in the first trimester.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So first trimester is entirely focused on knowing the teratogenic effects. Second trimester is focused on what? Maternal illness, maternal conditions affecting the fetal growth. There it was embryo. Now we have come to the fetus. So what are the maternal conditions that are going to affect the fetus?
Anemia.
Maternal malnutrition. Maternal anemia. Very good. Maternal anemia, malnutrition,
diabetes.
Very good.
Pregnancy-induced hypertension.
Yes, it comes in a little later than early third trimester and late second trimester. So as far as our country is concerned, maternal anemia, maternal malnutrition, then medical conditions, mother, if she has any other medical conditions. So in the second trimester, you will say there is no history suggest you of maternal anemia because you have got the hemoglobin done. So maternal anemia, maternal malnutrition, pregnancy induced hypertension, diabetes. So these are all the maternal conditions which can have an impact on the fetus. Okay. Then what are the other things that can have an impact in the second trimester of pregnancy? Because now we have to look at the growing uterus, the placenta, the umbilical cord, and the fetus. We want good flow to the child. Intrauterine conditions have to be ruled out.
Yes, ma'am. So what is placental abnormalities like placenta previa and placenta accreta and all, abnormal positioning of placenta.
Yeah. So here you can, you will not be asking it here, but a little kind of obstetric conditions that can affect the fetal growth. Okay, one of the things that you should always keep at the back of your mind is intrauterine infections and predominantly urinary tract infection, because urinary tract infection is asymptomatic. That is why all the time, whenever a pregnant woman goes for her tests, they do a urine routine, albumin and microscopic examination. Okay,
yes,
so here you'll ask, you will have, we finished the dating scan. Anomaly scan, dating scan. Now, there are 10 components, 10 to 15 components in dating and anomaly scan, which you should look at and make a list of it and learn it. Okay. Third trimester, what is it that we are bothered about the third trimester? And quickening, we say fetal kick count. How many times a child should have a fetal kick count? Kick count?
You'll ask the 14, mother about, more than 10 to 14 times.
Yes. Okay. Kick count, you'll ask. In third trimester, what is it that you are thinking about? Third trimester, everything related to the delivery of the baby. Okay. So here, what are the components that you'll be asking? Ma'am. Can you hear me, Shashank? Yes.
Ma'am, again, urinary tract infections can.
Yes, ma'am. The pregnancy conditions will continue, no? Okay. What is happening if she was diabetic in the second trimester? Is it controlled?
And
in addition, you'll ask about?
Yes, ma'am.
Urinary tract infection, you'll ask about? Pregnancy induced hypertension?
Those can lead to oligohydramnios, polyhydramnios.
Yeah. Here you will ask about whether there is somebody has sent a message, burning mixed urination. Yes. And then you'll ask about bleeding per vagina, whether it is painless, painful bleeding, because these are all an indication about preterm labor or urinary tract infection, which is the greatest hallmark of preterm labor. Okay, next one. Good.
Yes, ma'am. I'll go to the next slide, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, natal history, the normal vaginal delivery at term conducted at the hospital, birth order is 1. The birth weight was 2.6 kgs. The child cried immediately after birth. Vitamin K was given. Breastfeeding was initiated around 30 minutes after birth. And the mother was taught about the correct technique of breastfeeding in the hospital. The child had no NICU admissions.
Okay. Here, since it was a hospital delivery, in an educated woman, you can also ask about the APGAR score if it is available. What about vitamin K agreed? What about the BCG and oral polio drops? All this should be given at birth, no?
Yes, ma'am. I've included that in immunization history, ma'am.
You should come here also.
Okay.
Natal history means tuck, tuck, tuck. BCG, oral polio and vitamin K given. Okay.
Yes,
okay, next.
Postnatal history is girl child passed her urine and meconium within 24 hours after birth. No prelactial feeds were given and was exclusively breastfed on demand. There was no history of yellowish discoloration of skin and sclera.
Okay. There
is a postnatal period.
What do you mean by postnatal history? Do you think we use the word postnatal history in pediatrics? You said postnatal clinics are run by which department? OBG department, right? What is it? Antenatal, natal, neonatal history. Because the word postnatal, people are using interchangeably, means up to 6 weeks. So in an obstetric condition, it is up to 6 weeks for the uterus, everything to get back to place. You know, that is why any deaths happening to the mother within 6 weeks of delivery, the responsibility lies on the hospital that conducted the delivery. So I don't want that 6 weeks because we don't extend. Neonatal history is up to first 28 days of life. Okay, I used to teach undergraduate. Number 2 is passed on first day. Number 1 is passed on second day. Meconium and urine. Very important. Okay, next one. What do you mean by prelactial feeds? Definition of prelactial feeds? If you know,
prelactial feeds are the foods that are given out of superstition before initiation of breastfeeding.
Not superstition. It is anything given before starting breastfeeding.
Yes, ma'am.
No, don't use too many words. English is a very precise language and science is even more precise. Any food feed given prior to lacteal means breastfeeding is called prelactial feed. Good.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, next one.
Developmental history. In gross motor domain, the child was able to stand without support at 12 months and is able to walk alone at 15 months and is able to climb up the stairs at 18 months and this is normal. And fine motor history, mature pincer grasp was developed at around 12 months. Scribbling and the child was able to build 2 blocks at 15 months and a tower of 3 blocks at 18 months and this is also normal. Social domain, the child comes when the mother calls and this was noticed at around 12 months and is able to copy the parents' actions at around 18 months.
What is copy? What is imitation? When does a child copy? When does a child imitate?
Ma'am, copy is like some action of the parents which they have done, and the child will try to do that sometime later.
So copy means, Shashank, I'm holding my pen and I'm drawing a circle. Can you see that? I'm holding my pen and drawing a circle. Okay. Yes. The child will also do that. That is copying.
Yes.
Okay. And then I'm doing some movements like this. That is imitation. Am I clear? Okay. I know that all these things would have not been done, because what do you mean by a two-block tower? Do you have towers? So you must buy all this. Hopingly that COVID will settle down and you can examine the child growth and development. I would like to skip, because unless we have to have a marathon session on this. So many things to do in growth and development. So I'll accept that the child's gross motor, fine motor will tell us about the motor milestones. Social and language will tell us the mental milestones. We'll accept that this child is normal. Okay, next one.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Immunization history. The child is fully immunized till date.
Mm-hmm.
She has received the birth dose of OPV, BCG and hepatitis B. And at 6 and 14 weeks, she has taken OPV pentavalent and rotavirus along with fractionated IPV at...
What do you want to tell me about OPV? What type of OPD you want to... OPV we want to say?
Ma'am?
OPV, what do you want to say? Is it bivalent OPV?
Bivalent OPV, ma'am.
Yeah. Oral drug. What you should do know, Shashank, use this opportunity that you are knowing everything well. So, bivalent oral positive vaccine was given. Then, rotavirus, I'm really surprised that this child has got so many things which setup, I don't know, because rotavirus has started in certain parts of India and not everywhere. Everything seemed to be fitting into everything perfectly. Okay. So you must tell about that. And then fractional, we are giving in government setup, fractional injectable polio vaccine. It is given at 6 weeks and 14 weeks like that. Okay. So yes, we must go into little more details. And you say the child, as far as this chart is concerned, the child is immunized up to date. Fully immunized till date, okay, but immunized up to date.
Yes,
okay. Okay, fine. Next one.
Yes, ma'am. Diet history. The child was exclusively breastfed for the first 6 months, and complementary feeding was started after 6 months. Mm-hmm. The family is a lacto-vegetarian, and she consumes approximately around 775 calories per day. Mm-hmm. And this was done by 24-hour recall method, which was prior to the onset of illness.
Mm-hmm.
And according to the calculations, the observed protein intake was 14.4 grams per day, and the required amount is 18 grams. So it is deficient by 3.6 grams, which accounts to around 20%. And the required calories for her age is 1,200 kilocalories. And it's again deficient by around 400 kilocalories and accounts for 36%.
Is the child on breastfeeding or not?
She is on breastfeeding, ma'am. She's the mother told approximately around 300 ml plus 100 ml cow's milk.
So what is the mistake that has happened? The mother should never have given the cow milk. Number one.
Yes, ma'am.
The mother will not know that she secreted 300 ml of milk. We have no way of knowing how much milk the mother is secreting. Therefore, this child is 18 months old. Okay, I put up this chart in my breastfeeding session. So the what you should calculate is 40% of the calories come from breastfeeding if the mother is breastfeeding. So next slide.
Yes,
so child is required calories is 1,200 calories per day, right? Absurd calories 775 kilocalories per day. Can somebody quickly calculate 40% of 775 is what? Let's make it as 800. Yes, somebody quickly calculate 40%. Okay, I'll say calories that the child is getting is 1,000 calories. Okay.
Yes, it will become 400
calories.
Or in this case, it will become 320
calories. 40% of 775, somebody has calculated and helped us. So 320 calories will come from breast milk.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, 40%, because the child is now 12 to 24 months, 40% of the calories come from breast milk. So yes, in 775 minus 320, and how much do you get it? 450 calories must come from your complementary feeding.
Yes, ma'am.
So previous slide. Yeah. Yes, now you will calculate the calories that you got from the complementary feeding. Again, somebody quickly calculate 75, 90, 110, 90, and 110.
Yes, ma'am. So 475 approximately.
So the child should have got how much from complementary feeding?
Ma'am, but the complementary feeding should have been more because the required calories is 1,200. So it should be around 800 calories.
So the child has got how much?
The child has got only around 450 calories.
So child has got 450 calories from complementary feeding. Now we will use that to, when we do the anthropometric measurements. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So here we did not take the 100 ml of milk. Immediately you must have. Why should you not give milk below the age of 2 years for children? I have dealt extensively in my class on complementary feeding. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Complementary feeding class, I have dealt extensively on that. If you introduce a milk diet, again in milk, you know, what milk will you like to give? How many types of milk are there? And how should it be given?
Different animals, cow, buffalo, goat.
No, which milk did the mother give? Do they have a cow at home?
No, ma'am, they are giving Nandini milk.
Nandini is not a cow milk, no, it's a dairy milk.
Yes, ma'am.
It is not from a single cow.
Yes, ma'am, yes.
You should not say cow's milk. Either you say top milk or dairy milk.
Yes, ma'am.
And in dairy milk, you'll specify which milk?
Blue packet.
Blue packet. Why is it important to tell that?
That amount of fat present will be varying in blue or
orange and all. Okay. Supposing I say that I have given this child the orange milk. Orange packet Nandini milk.
That will have more fat, ma'am. And
how much is it?
Around 7 or 8 grams.
6 grams. Tomorrow, okay. Whenever your mother is making coffee for you, just take that Nandini packet and read out all the contents, nutrition labeling of all this. Okay.
Yes,
so you should, number one, she should not have given. So the first advice I would tell this mother is stop it. Because now, how is she giving it? Diluted or undiluted?
Undiluted, ma'am.
So undiluted. So just that Nandini milk will not give 75 calories. It will give you 65 calories.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So if at all it is required, it should be boiled, cooled, undiluted, blue packet Nandini milk. For every 100 ml, add 10 grams of sugar to bring up the nutritive value to 100 calories.
Yes,
so that's the maximum calorie one can give. But I do not want this child to be receiving the Nandini milk. And how is it given? That's also very important.
Ma'am, in a glass they are giving.
In the glass? This is a 15 months old child. You think the child can hold the glass and drink?
No, ma'am. The mother is feeding with a glass, ma'am.
With a glass or pallada? You must ask. You must ask. Now you know. You must ask all that history and why it is important.
Yes, ma'am.
Because you said the child has got post-assive vomiting. And then somewhere you were trying to tell me that I would like to ask about diarrhea because respiratory infection can cause diarrhea. One of the common causes for diarrhea is faulty feeding by this mother. And this is where the faulty nutrition also happens. Okay. If she's feeding by cup feeding, it is okay. What is nipple confusion?
That whenever they initiate this bottle feeding very early, the baby will prefer nipple only better than the human breast, ma'am. The baby will not be able to differentiate this thing.
Yeah.
And it will lead to improper breastfeeding.
Can you see my hand?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Whenever a baby is breastfeeding, okay, the baby opens the mouth wide and the breast tissue has to go inside. Okay. This is the technique. Chin will touch the breast. Lower areola in the baby's mouth. Lips are inverted. Okay. Most lower areola, chin has touched the breast. Lips are inverted. This is the actual attachment. If I do bottle feeding, I am doing like this.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And during that time, it is like drinking juice with a straw.
Yes, ma'am.
Whereas in breastfeeding, it is like biting a big piece of an hamburger or toast or whatever, like that you do. So when a child is taken to the breast, the child will close his mouth. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So this is called as nipple confusion. This will not over any time it can set in. And it destroys the whole fantastic phenomenon of breastfeeding.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So that is that mistake that has happened here. And you must also write when it was started, all that. Okay. You have written idli, rice, sambar and all that. A simple rule of thumb is any you have grams, grains. Okay. Grains, grams. Any grains means rice, akki bele, akki ragi, jola, like that. All these are grains. So all grains will give you anywhere from 300 to 350 calories. I've seen the poor students sitting and by hearting rice contains 300 calories and it contains 3 grams of proteins, ragi like that, wheat contains, no need. A general rule of thumb is all grains contain 300 to 350 calories. 100 grams of dry weight. Okay. Mm-hmm. Then grains. Grams means esri bele, uddin bele, kadle bele, dals, all that. Okay. Mm-hmm. All these dals contain 300 to 325 calories per 100 grams of dry weight. And the protein content is anywhere from 6 to 12 grams, with some nuts having up to 24 grams, like ground nuts. So just simple, you remember that. 1 teaspoon of oil will 45, every 5 ml will give 9 calories. So 45 calories per teaspoon of oil. 1 teaspoon of sugar will give 4 calories. So 1 teaspoon of sugar will 20 calories. So that is why the moment you have written 75 calories here, I knew that calculation was wrong. Okay, so you must ask everything, because nutrition impacts the children so much. Every time people are asking what is immunity booster during COVID and all that, no such thing at all. Our routine food, we should give it properly. Ensure that 55% of the food we give contains carbohydrates and 20 to 25% contains proteins and 30% is fats. So if you do that, the child will get its immunity booster, because the immunological system is heavily dependent on your proteins. And you did say that there is a protein deficiency. So if we have this, if we are causing malnutrition because of the diet problems, that a child with malnutrition is prone for infection, malnutrition, it becomes a very vicious cycle. So please concentrate sincerely on the diet chart in a child who's less than 2 years old and also 5 years old. Am I clear, Shashank?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, next one.
From family history, it is a non-consanguineous marriage and the birth order.
First born child of a non-consanguineous married couple. We don't expect similar complaints in the family. When would I have explained similar complaints? Do you expect all family members to be having fever, cough and hurried breathing?
If it is something like viral infection.
Now you can defend yourself by saying, ma'am, there is COVID going on. So maybe other family members were having the symptoms and the child got it, acceptable. Okay. Yes, but every time a child comes with some diarrhea, then they'll ask, the student says no similar complaints in the family. Unless it is food poisoning, you can't use that. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. In the family history, this is enough. No history suggests you of what else. If I want to say something in the family history, what else?
ETS. Congenital abnormalities.
No. All that will come there. Family history of what, which can cause fever, cough and cold? One is COVID. Another one is any smokers.
Yes,
because
ma'am.
We discussed nocturnal cough, you remember?
Yes,
so it is called environmental tobacco smoking. If is there, no history suggests you of any ETS, environmental tobacco smoking. Very good. Okay, family history. Next. This we will skip.
Some smokers had written under this, ma'am. Smokers had written under socioeconomic factors.
Okay. But you can bring it to family history, because you wanted to say something about like no similar complaints, no? So to add up to your history, like if you for towards your history, you can bring whenever it is okay, but you should be able to explain.
Yes,
okay?
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
No known smokers in the family. No smokers in the family. No history suggest you of any smokers in the family. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Because we don't register smokers and say unknown smokers and known smokers. Next one, Prashant.
Summary, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
this 1.5 year old girl born out of non-consanguineous marriage of birth order one, a full-term normal vaginal delivery belonging to a lower socioeconomic family, according to modified Kuposwami scale, presents with a fever from past 4 days, cough from past 3 days, and hurried breathing from past 3 days. There was no history of similar complaints in the past. Her diet is deficient by 425 kilocalories and 3.6 grams of proteins per day. She is developmentally normal and immunized up to date. And I would like to think the cause of this illness as a lower respiratory tract infection, probably of bacterial nature.
Okay, why do you want to think of lower respiratory tract? What component in your history has helped you to think that it is a lower respiratory tract?
Hurried breathing and...
Very good. That's it. I don't want to make any more comments. Excellent summary, Shashank. I wish I can throw a chocolate for you. Very good summary. Okay. Yes. Now, with this, what do you think?
Any other things?
I want to know which are the conditions which cause fever, cough, and hurried breathing. One, you told me it's a lower respiratory tract infection. Nowadays, we are not, at history level, we can think of a lower respiratory tract infection. If it was a postgraduate, I would have asked them to tell me 10 differential diagnoses for this. But at your stage, what are the probable diagnoses? One is lower respiratory tract infection. Why do you think it is bacterial in nature?
One, because the onset was sudden. It was not, and there was no other family members who were having this. Mm. And between two febrile periods, the child was not active.
Whatever you said, I don't accept it. Because of fever, high fever. Remember, viral fevers and bacterial fevers are some 4, 5, 10 differentiating things. So in a child with viral fever, child will not have high fever, but it will be a moderate fever. Child is very active. Okay.
Yes.
In between fever. So here the child was, you said, irritable, excessive crying. Okay. And was vomiting. So all these points go in favor of a bacterial in nature. In a viral fever, it's a well child. In a child with bacterial infection, it is a sick child. My favorite professor, Dr. M.L. Sidraju, he always used to say, when a student used to write a letter and say, I could not kindly grant me leave because I was suffering from a viral fever. So he would always tell, why do you want to say viral fever? Because viral fever will not cause you so much of sickness. I'm again telling you, COVID will now slowly creep in our future history tracking. Okay. Because now we have got COVID pre-symptomatic, asymptomatic, mild, moderate, severe, etc. So till that creeps into our history and all that, we will presently say this, because of this, I'm thinking of bacterial. Viral fevers will not require an admission very rarely. We said about bronchiolitis, etc. In such situations, the child would come to the hospital. Otherwise, most of the viral fevers are all an unphenomenon. They'll come and they will go, except one viral fever, which we are very concerned. Which one is that?
The respiratory syncytial virus.
No, all that will touch and go. Influenza virus. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Influenza virus, we are really worried. That's why the influenza vaccine will start below 6 months and to family members, etc. Okay, next one. Excellent summary, son. Okay.
General physical examination.
So you are thinking of a lower respiratory tract infection, query bacterial. I wanted one or two other, one more differential diagnosis, probably COVID. Next one, you want to say another one? Where you get fever, cough, and hurried breathing?
Lung consolidation.
Lung consolidation. Okay, enough. These two conditions, enough. Okay, next one.
General physical examination. The child is conscious, sick looking. The examination was done on mother's lap in adequate lighting and exposure after obtaining consent. The vitals, temperature was around 101 degree Fahrenheit.
Do you think it is fever or not? I don't know what is 101 degree Fahrenheit. Is it fever?
Yes, ma'am.
In Fahrenheit, what temperature? At what temperature we say fever? Above?
Above 99.5.
Yes. Okay, the child has fever. Next one.
Pulse is 120 beats per minute, regular in rhythm, normal in volume, no radio-radial delay and no radio-femoral delay. And respiratory rate was around 70 breaths per minute. Blood pressure was 100 by 60 millimeters of mercury. Saturation was around 92-93%. And capillary filling time was around 3 seconds.
Excellent. So what did you think with the vitals, what is your conclusion?
And the child has fever and the breathing is 70 breaths per minute. The cutoff was for tachypnea at this age is around at 40.
Yeah, not around 60.
Yes, yes, at
below
40.
Below 2 months 60, 2 months to 1 year it is 50. Then 12 months to 60 months it is 60, and after 5 years it is 30. Okay,
yes,
so definitely the breath respiratory rate is tachypneic.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, what does tachypneic mean? When the child is tachypneic, what is the immediate thing that should come to your mind according to IMNCI?
Ma'am, that is the pneumonia is severe.
No, and, we have three classifications.
Yes,
pneumonia,
ma'am.
No pneumonia, severe pneumonia. One more which we did when we did the pneumonia project, very severe pneumonia and very, very severe pneumonia. These are the other two extra classifications for postgraduates. For an undergraduate, it is no pneumonia, pneumonia, and severe pneumonia. So
yes,
when
ma'am.
Do I say pneumonia?
Pneumonia is when the child is having...
just based on this respiratory rate. I just want to talk on the respiratory rate.
Ma'am, whenever the child is tachypneic, it's...
More than 50 breaths means pneumonia.
Pneumonia.
Yeah. When do I say severe pneumonia?
So it's more than 60.
No. Upper chest, lower chest, lower chest retractions.
Will be there, then there will be
severe pneumonia. So to say severe pneumonia, tachypnea.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. To say very severe pneumonia, tachypnea plus lower chest indrawing.
Yes, ma'am.
We don't use the word retractions. Retractions means visible contraction of the intercostal muscles. So
yes,
you must
ma'am.
Know what is retraction, what is indrawing. Upper chest, lower chest and lower abdomen. So
yes,
tachypnea plus lower chest indrawing, unless proved otherwise, is severe pneumonia. And those of you know purple book of OPGY, remember that OPGY, the latest edition, please
yes,
go through the latest things that are incorporated for IMNCI. Just go through it, no chart booklet it has got. In that there are some new things that have been added on, which you should know about it. Okay, next one. Very
mm-hmm.
good vitals. Very good you have done. Next one.
Next, anthropometry, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. We'll come to the anthropometry. What did you use? Did you use the WHO charts or
yes,
what?
WHO charts.
Yeah, so below 5 years, current recommendation is WHO multicentric growth charts, and above 5 years, the IAP growth charts.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, what is the thing that you have found here?
And the child is having a low weight, but the weight is around less than minus 1 centimeter. Hello, ma'am.
Somebody's, we must ask them to unmute there. Mute there. Can somebody mute it? Sanjana, please mute it. Okay. I'm not able to see this part of it. Yeah. Weight is below what standard deviation?
Minus 1 standard deviation.
So what does that mean?
That means the child is underweight but not malnourished, undernourished.
Below 2 standard deviation we say?
Below 2 is undernourished, below 3 is malnourished.
So this child is just in that borderline, so you can really do lots and save the child's brain. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Height is okay. Did you take the height or did you take the length?
Length, ma'am.
Okay. Then head circumference, all these parameters are normal. Upper
but,
segment, lower segment, unless indicated, we don't take it.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. See, so beautifully your anthropometry is correlating. Your weight is minus 1 standard deviation. Your mid upper arm circumference is 13.1 centimeter. It should have been 13.5 to say normal. And we also
yes,
had a caloric deficit. We had a protein deficit. So everything is correlating because you have done an excellent diet chart. You have done excellent calculations. Now you understand.
Yes,
so weight for eight, etc. Minus 1 standard deviation and your mid upper arm circumference. All your weight for age, height for length, and mid upper arm circumference. All of them are suggestive of a very mild malnutrition. Okay, next one.
Yes, ma'am. Next is hetero examination.
Mm-hmm.
Hairs are normal has normal luster. The fontanelles are closed. Eyes has no pallor and eyes has pallor and no jaundice.
Why did you expect jaundice in this child, 15-month-old child? Did you expect? Why do you want to get caught in that? Does history, the fever, cough, and hurried breathing suggest anything related to hepatobiliary system? Nothing.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay.
And the ears are normal. Nasal flaring is seen. The lips are normal. Oral cavity is the mucosa is normal. There is no cleft lip or cleft palate.
I'll accept no cleft lip or cleft palate because of the postaccia. But it's a postaccia vomiting. Routinely, we don't look at it. Or throat examination, you can put like that. But, you know, again, accepted with a pinch of salt. Okay, next one.
Abdomen, genitalia, spine, back, lower limbs are normal. Nails, skin are normal. Edema is not present.
Did you expect edema to be present? How many types of edema we have? We just now had a lot of discussion on anthropometric measurements, right?
Yes.
So you said the child has got minus one standard deviation. At minus one standard deviation, do you get edema? In the last class, we did discuss about what are the conditions for severe acute malnutrition, etc. Can you recall? One is weight criteria.
Yes, weight for this weight for length, and one more is visible bilateral edema and
bipedal
edema. Then visible signs of malnutrition. And one is middle
upper arm circumference, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So did we have anything like that here?
No.
So why do you want to suddenly bring edema? Do you want to say that no, this child has got respiratory infection, so then it went for congestive? What other things? You should not get into a mess like that. How many types of edema are there?
Pitting and non-pitting.
Apart from that? How long do you press for pitting edema to see?
10 seconds on the...
10 seconds? How long do you press for capillary refill time? How long do you list the lymph for to remove the venous condition or lymph test? It is all based on the capillaries, then venular drainage and arterial drainage. Okay. So capillary refill time, you press for 5 seconds, you press for the jaundice, etc. for 5 seconds to dispel the blood. So in a case, in edema, we have to press for 30 seconds.
Okay. Oh, yes,
so that is it. So what are the type? One is nutritional edema. So did you expect nutritional edema at minus one standard deviation?
No, ma'am.
Very good. Next, what is other edema?
Another one is because of the
cardiac edema.
Cardiac edema, renal edema.
Did you expect any cardiac edema here?
No, ma'am.
No. Then you very good. You said renal edema. Do you think it's a renal condition?
No, ma'am.
No. Do you think it's a hepatic condition?
No, ma'am.
Hepatic disorders. Then do you think it is angioneurotic edema or some allergic edema?
No, ma'am.
Drug induced?
No, ma'am.
That's it. Good. Next one.
Examination of respiratory system. The upper respiratory tract, nasal flaring was seen. Nasal septum is normal. The skin over the sinus appears normal.
What sinuses are developed at 1.5 years?
I'm only ethmoid sinus, ma'am.
So I don't think we should be pressing on the sinus, irritating the child and all that. Okay. Which is the sinus? When do you say frontal sinusitis? There are many PGs will say frontal sinusitis.
And frontal sinus is the last to develop. It develops around, seven years.
So at birth, we have sphenoidal sinuses. Subsequently, it is ethmoidal sinus, then maxillary sinus, then frontal sinus and mastoid sinus somewhere in this in between period.
Then examination of the lower respiratory tract.
No. Oropharynx, you said normal. No tonsillar enlargement. You don't want to say anything about the teeth. When you said about cleft lip and cleft palate, don't you want to say something about the tongue, under surface of the tongue, gums, etc.? So oral cavity means all this.
Yes, ma'am.
Gums, teeth, tongue, anterior pillar, posterior pillar, then tonsils, then the pharynx. So you're supposed to quickly make it. My father always used to say, he used to make us invest a lot on tongue depressors. He always used to say, just like the surgery people, you would say, unless you do an abdominal distension, per rectal examination. In pediatrics, if you are not examining the oral cavity with a tongue depressor, you put your foot in grave, and this should be the last one. But as far as COVID is concerned, never do a upper respiratory infection unless you are in a strongly suspect some epiglottitis, something stuck there and all that, with all the resuscitation measures, with PPE and all that. But the standard rule now is do not do a throat examination in children because of the COVID pandemic. Got my point?
Yes, okay. Lower respiratory tract examination. On inspection, the shape of the chest was elliptical. The movements were equal on both sides. The trachea appears to be central, nipples at the same level. The apex speed was not visible. There were subcostal retractions and the accessory muscles of respirations were used. There were no dilated veins, drooping of shoulder or overcrowding of ribs.
Why did you say drooping of shoulder?
Ma'am, if it is any apical lobe involvement, that time the shoulder will be, shoulder drooping will be seen.
So you think in 3 days the child will have so much and the shoulders droop? So do, let us not fix something that doesn't exist. What else would you like to see? I mean, I'll accept it if you are suspecting some sort of a diaphragmatic paralysis, injury like that. Okay. So no need for all that because it's just a very acute history. Do you feel there is overcrowding of ribs or not overcrowding of ribs?
No overcrowding of ribs.
Yeah, I would have expected a collapse for overcrowding of ribs to happen. No.
Yes, ma'am.
But history is not suggesting that unless there's a foreign body. History doesn't suggest a foreign body infection in a foreign body at all. Okay. Foreign body, ma'am. Though it's an acute history, 1.5 year old child is unlikely because all the time the child is under the supervision of the mother. You had written there feeding history accepted. Okay. There's something called diet history, feeding history. Under nutrition history, you get feeding history and diet history. Okay. Feeding history is as long as the mother is feeding the child. Okay. And diet history is when the child is able to feed himself. So it's all very precise. Okay, son, move on.
Yes, ma'am. On palpation, the inspectory findings were confirmed. There is no local rise in temperature. The trachea is central. The apical impulse was felt at the fourth intercostal space at the mid-axillary line. The chest expansion was equal on both sides. The vocal tremors was not elicited.
Why you want to say no local rise in temperature? Did you accept some abscess, something? Calla, robot, all of tumor? This child, it is not relevant here. No local rise of temperature, unless I'm having an abscess. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, next one.
On percussion, the mammary and the infraaxillary area on the right side had dull note. Other areas were resonant, ma'am.
Very good. Next.
And on auscultation, the same areas, the mammary and the infraaxillary areas had bronchial breath sounds with crepitations. The other areas had normal vestibular breath sounds.
One minute. If you're saying bronchial breathing and you're saying dull note, does that go together? When do you say bronchial breathing?
Whenever the air intake is less, whenever the air entry is reduced.
So it should be collapsed. So you're able to make out the air entry, right? Whenever air entry is reduced, you never hear a bronchial breathing. To hear a bronchial breathing, there should be air entry.
Yes, okay? Ma'am.
So we'll check on that. So it should be diminished air entry and crepitations. If you want to say bronchial breathing, your findings should go for what? For a consolidation.
Yes, ma'am.
Your findings are looking like pneumonia. Right.
Yes.
So if
yes,
it is pneumonia, you have a dull to percuss, and if there's a bronchial breathing, then it is consolidation.
Yes, ma'am.
When there's consolidation, the bronchial airway will be trans. You can hear the sounds. Okay.
Yes. And
okay. Next.
The system examinations were normal. And diagnosis is this is a case of lower respiratory tract infection, severe pneumonia of the light lower lobe, mostly of bacterial etiology.
Okay, you can severe pneumonia, the terminology we use it as in the probable diagnosis. Now you have finished the examination, in your provisional diagnosis, you will say it is a right lower lobe pneumonia. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
And your bacterial etiology, right. Now, whenever you are trying to put a diagnosis, though this is a very acute history, whenever you are putting the diagnosis, what are the things that you will ask? Number first question you will ask is, Is it upper or a lower respiratory? I'll ask you the questions. You tell me what it is. Is it upper or a lower respiratory tract?
Lower respiratory tract.
Why do you say it's a lower respiratory tract?
For hurried breathing. History of hurried breathing and
hurried breathing can be any part.
Yes, ma'am. And on examination, the upper respiratory tract was and the lower respiratory tract examination showed on percussion there was dullness and
all your findings. Okay. Yes. Therefore, so I have to decide if it's upper or lower respiratory tract. Next one, I have to decide whether it is the right side or the left side.
Yes, ma'am. The notes were dull only on the one side and
right side. Okay. So how many lobes are there on the right side?
Three lobes.
Upper, middle, and lower. So which lobe?
Right lower lobe, I think.
Right lower lobe. Then what do you think is the pathology there?
Pneumonia.
Pneumonia. Why do you think it is pneumonia? Like, you got it? So you have to decide whether it is pneumonia, whether it is collapse, whether it is consolidation, whether it is syn-pneumonic effusion, all that, right? If you approach like this, you will never miss anything. Next, I accept, very good. Plus, what would you write? We said something about
undernourished child.
Yeah, with my minus one standard deviation. So undernutrition. Okay, that has to come here. With what else?
With no complications.
Faulty feeding.
Yes, ma'am. Faulty
feeding. Your complications, the child has come to the hospital, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So we have you can't say no complications.
Yes, ma'am.
What are the complications I expect in a child who has got pneumonia?
Ma'am, it can progress to consolidation and it can progress to empyema.
Pleural effusion, empyema, like that. Okay, local complications and systemic complications. Okay, we just have another 10 minutes. So, okay, next one, that's it.
Yes, ma'am, that's the history.
Do you have the picture of the X-ray?
No, ma'am, I couldn't get.
Okay, if at all, a digital X-ray if you can get. So when I look at a chest X-ray, what are the 10 P's I should look in a chest X-ray? Indications for chest X-ray. Is it routinely indicated?
No, ma'am, it's not routinely
indicated. Never. Okay, you should say never.
Yes, ma'am.
Indicated when?
Ma'am, it's indicated if the treatment is not...
community acquired pneumonia is progressing for complications.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then?
When the child is not responding to treatment.
Yeah, very good. So if I put the X-ray, 10 P's which you should discuss is, you should look at the position of the X-ray. Okay, you got the clavicles, ma'am. You have the air bronchogram and spine. So that is number one, position. Penetration, adequate or inadequate. You should be able to see the cardia wire and the air in the respiratory passage will look black. Bones will look white, okay, prominent white. Okay, so position, penetration, then?
Next is the pathology.
AP or which view? AP, that view. Below 1.5 years, it will always be AP view. Next one. Yes, you look at the periphery.
Yes, ma'am.
Pleura, pericardium, pretracheal, paratracheal. So they're like P's. So next time when you do a respiratory tract infection, just for the discussion's sake, we can have one chest X-ray. Okay. Now, shall I take up the questions, Shashank? Do you have any doubts from what we discussed now?
No, ma'am.
You don't have any doubts?
No, ma'am.
Okay, are you comfortable? Somebody has written pain abdomen here.
Pain abdomen.
So what are they trying to tell us?
I think it was after burning micturition.
Pneumonia. Yeah, that was in obstetric history. Pain abdomen, not so much of a pain abdomen they'll come with. So it has to be urinary tract infection. I've seen a lot of questions, but they're not appearing here. Okay, then 30 seconds, very good for pitting and not pitting anymore. The caloric they have calculated. Where are the other questions? I'm not able to see all the questions.
Ma'am, they have answered in the chat section.
No, I put it in the chat. I have only 320 and urinary tract infection like that.
Okay.
Before that, there were many questions. I'm not able to see those questions. Okay, if there are no questions, anything else?
A management part.
Yeah, management of, 1 minute. It's there. Yeah, we got all the questions here. Okay, now number one, they are put here as paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, gastroesophageal reflex, very good. And among the symptoms of the respiratory tract infection, it is wheeze and grunts. What is wheeze? Is an external obstruction. Grunt is an ominous sign. Okay. It signifies that the child is no longer able to, it's an uncompromised respiratory tract, sore throat, crying, all that is what we asked in the history, symptom analysis of the system. Okay, Sonika, come here. I have to bring it down. Yeah. Management, how do you manage, Shashank? Broad lines of management.
First is supportive treatment.
Why you want us to do supportive treatment? Specific.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Since
do you want to do any? Do you want to do any investigations,
ma'am? One is throat sore for COVID, ma'am.
Very good. Next one.
And then complete blood count.
Complete blood count. What do you expect in a bacterial infection?
There'll be a neutrophils will be elevated.
Bacterial and, infection counts, total counts, differential counts. You must go in a systematic way. What will happen to total counts?
Total counts are elevated.
Normal total counts is 5 to 15,000 at this age. So total counts will be elevated. Differential count, what happens?
There will be neutrophilia.
Increased neutrophilia. What happens to basophils? What happens to eosinophils?
Eosinophils will be normal, ma'am.
I'm just trying to confuse you. Eosinophils and basophils are normal. Okay. Yes, now, if I have this as a viral pneumonia, I say, no, Shashank, this is viral pneumonia.
Lymphocytes will be elevated.
Lymphocytes will be elevated. What happens to the total counts?
The total count will be reduced.
It will not be so high.
No.
Okay. Yeah. Lymphocyte, a total count will be less and lymphocyte predominates viral pneumonias. Okay.
Yes,
so simple CBC. Because we had malnutrition in this child and diet, there were some deficiencies. I would like to do what? Do you want to do hemoglobin? You said no pallor. So don't do unnecessary investigations. You know, a child hates you when you do prick him unnecessarily and all that. So you must become child friendly tomorrow if you want to flourish as a pediatrician. Okay. So like that, unnecessary investigations are not required. Just for investigation sake and teaching sake, I'm saying CBC. We have very clearly right from the beginning, you've been saying it's a bacterial pneumonia. So now do you want to give this child oral antibiotics or IV antibiotics?
IV antibiotics.
Why? Because the child has some danger signs.
Yeah, it's severe pneumonia. And
what are the danger signs? Pneumonia. Danger signs. Excessive crying.
Retraction.
Irritability. Lethargy. All that. Therefore, we have to start IV antibiotics. So which are the common IV antibiotics for community acquired pneumonia? In other words, what are the organisms expected below the age of 2 years?
Streptococcus pneumonia.
Very, very good.
And it can be Staphylococcus aureus, Klebsiella or E. coli.
Top is pneumococcal or streptococcus pneumonia.
Yes,
second one is H. influenza. Third one is
Staph aureus.
Then Klebsiella.
Klebsiella and E. coli.
Then lower down like that. Okay. So in a bacterial pneumonia, we're expecting this. Are these organisms gram positive or gram negative?
Gram positive.
Gram positive. So the ideal antibiotics that you should be using here is?
Cell wall inhibitors.
Which antibiotic would you?
Like ampicillin and gentamicin.
Yeah. So how long would you like to give those antibiotics?
Antibiotics would be given for a period of 5 days or until the child shows visible recovery. Then we can shift it to oral.
Oral antibiotics. Okay. What will you advise the mother? After advised in the hospital, advised. Do you want to give some oxygen and all that for this child? Now we don't have oxygen.
Again, if the
saturation. So one is you're going to give a specific treatment. You did a specific investigation. You gave a specific treatment for pneumonia. So what is the next thing that you will do? You will do the supportive treatment.
Yeah, for fever, we'll continue paracetamol.
Paracetamol.
And for.
There's nothing
else. If the oxygen saturation drops, that time we'll give supportive oxygen.
And this child is 95%, son. Don't waste oxygen on him.
Yes, ma'am. Fluids for correcting.
Fluids, IV or oral? Where is the electrolyte imbalance?
There's no electrolyte imbalance.
Why do you want to give fluids? What else will you do? I'll tell the mother no milk, frequent breastfeeding. Despite whatever the illness, a child will breastfeeding will be a nice satiety for it. Okay. It will be, I said passive, for breast milk can be a pacifier, appetizer. Yes, okay. And then dessert. So here, what will it be?
Pacifier.
Pacifier and also, and also a dessert, because whatever food you're giving, the taste would be numbed. Because I don't want to discuss, there's not much time for that. Yeah. So what else will you do? So you did a specific treatment. You improved on the fluids and nutrition. Fluids then, means not something in a Tetra pack, anything like that. It is whatever, after every feed, she will give some water. Okay. Boiled, safe drinking water like that. Okay. Next.
Yes, ma'am. And then advice for change in nutrition and...
Very good. You'll tell her, don't give, remove that cow's milk completely. I'm dead against it. Please leave the cow's milk for cows. Let not the cow start a war. We are facing the coronavirus, and next the cow will start attacking us if you take away the milk of its cough. Right?
Yes, ma'am.
I see you smiling finally. Yeah. Next, what?
Then also you can give when the next immunization should be there.
Very good. So you are going to book this patient to your wellness clinic and tell him, now that you are recovered completely, come for the next vaccination. Okay, what are the respiratory vaccines and what has happened with the respiratory problems? At the beginning only I told you 30% of the mortality below 5 years is because of respiratory infections. Okay, and they are often because of community acquired pneumonias and complications. So sometimes we ask, which are the cardiac vaccines, which are the respiratory vaccines?
We can tell them to take pneumococcal vaccine.
Oh-ho, before that?
Haemophilus influenza.
Before that, my time. What were we giving?
Measles, mumps and rubella.
Measles. Measles was a very bad killer, because measles used to cause 3 types of pneumonias. Okay. A measles pneumonia, post-measles complications, and when the eruptive fever was there, that time only there used to be measles. Measles is a virus or a bacteria?
It's a virus, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. And it was notoriously known for causing malnutrition and complication of bacterial infections. So measles vaccination took away a lot of our, helped in pneumonias and fast recovery of children, which was the next vaccine. We'll come in that order.
DPT.
Very good. In DPT, which component was causing very bad pneumonia? Pertussis. Pertussis. Okay. Next vaccine. You just now said.
Haemophilus influenza.
Now Indian Academy of Pediatrics has been recommending for every child after 6 months, the dose is same, 0.5 ml, universal dose. It should be given annually. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Next one. Which is the next one?
Pneumococcal vaccine, influenza vaccine.
Pneumococcal, you said H1 and influenza vaccine is that only, no? None one info. Pneumococcal vaccine. So now you'll get 5-star if you tell me the 5th vaccine.
Coronavirus vaccine.
Very good. Somebody next to you, ask them, because I don't know how to give virtual 5-star. Okay. So these are the respiratory vaccines. Similarly, there's something called cardiac vaccines. Which are the vaccines that prevent cardiac disease? Again, Professor Vijayalakshmi. Yeah. Which one?
Rubella will
prevent. So ask, you're staying with your parents or somebody? Ask them to give you something bonus, because Asha Benkappa rarely appreciates and you've done very well. Okay. So that's it. So you'll do the nutrition. You will, in anything in pediatrics, the first thing that should come is what we should do for growth and development. Second thing is immunization. Third thing is nutrition. Fourth thing is, I say you will book them for a follow-up visit. It is to ensure that the child is growing well. You will start up a wellness clinic so the children can come on a Saturday when you're free and you can discuss about many things, stimulation. You know, now they've come up with a big way called as early cognitive development or early childhood stimulation and all that. Because so many things are going on, the stress management like that. So all this becomes a component of that. Play therapy, role of toys. I just now told you, OP guy, latest edition, purple book has all this. Okay. Anything else, Prashant?
No.
Shashank, anybody else, anything?
Ma'am, in YouTube, one doubt was there. How is it pneumonia but not TB?
Short history. such an acute history. Usually tuberculosis will have a subacute or chronic history. Second one, history of contact. Okay. And the whatever your anthropometric parameters would be fall below that. Is it clear?
Yes.
Too early to think of tuberculosis.